causes and events leading up to our entry into the war. Well, what are the causes? Why are we Americans on the march? Is it because of... Is that why we are fighting? Or is it because of Britain?
You know, it's hard to know just how well it will turn out. There are a few things that were disconcerting. The stories about the private security firm not having enough people. The supposed strike of the immigration and customs officials. That obviously is not something which is encouraging. Because in the games, there are three parts that make games successful. Number one, of course, are the athletes. That's what overwhelmingly the games are about. Number two are the volunteers. And they'll have great volunteers here. But number three are the people of the country. Do they come together and celebrate the Olympic moment? And that's something which we only find out once the games actually begin.
I thought that Americans care little for what goes on outside their borders. One thing is for sure, though, they do care how their politicians look abroad. Well, that's what's been driving Mitt Romney's tour of America's closest allies this week. The presumptive Republican Party nominee, yes, we still have to call him that, has been to Britain and Israel and today ended the tour in Poland.
In the 1980s...
Well, with the US election now less than 100 days away, Romney's trying to prove himself the international statesman. But he's come under fire from individuals as diverse as the Mayor of London and a top Palestinian aide. Well, Beijing today also joined the chorus of condemnation. So few friends abroad, but what do Americans make of it all? Is Romney a gaffe-prone wannabe or a clever politician with his eye firmly fixed on the White House?
There are some people who are coming from around the world who don't yet know about all the preparations we've done to get London ready in the last 7 years. I hear there's a guy called Mitt Romney who wants to know whether we're ready. He wants to know whether we're ready. Are we ready? Are we ready?
France.
To buy a factory there. It employed about 20,000 people, and they were almost all
young women between the ages of about 18 and 22 or 23. They're saving for potentially becoming married, and they work in these huge factories. They make various small appliances. And as we were walking through this facility, seeing them work, the number of hours they work per day, the pittance they earn, living in dormitories with little bathrooms at the end of maybe 10 rooms. And in the rooms, they had 12 girls per room, three bunk beds on top of each other. Have you seen that? And around this factory was a fence, a huge fence with barbed wire and guard towers. And we said, gosh, I can't believe that you keep these girls in. They said, no, this is to keep other people from coming in, because people want so badly to come work in this factory that we have to keep them out, or they'll just come in here and start working and try and get compensated. So this is to keep people out. And they said, actually, at Chinese New Year, as the girls go home, sometimes they decide they've saved enough money and they don't come back to the factory. And he said, and so on the weekend after Chinese New Year, there'll be a line of people, hundreds long, outside the factory, hoping that some girls haven't come back and they can come to the factory. And so as we were experiencing this for the first time, we came to see a factory like this in China some years ago, the main partner I was with turned to me and said, 95% of life is settled if you're born in America. This is an amazing land. And what we have is unique, and fortunately it is so special, we're sharing it with the world.
Czechoslovakia. Norway. Albania, Yugoslavia, or Russia? What was it made us change our way of living overnight? What turned our resources, our machines, our whole nation into one vast arsenal, producing more and more weapons of war instead of the old materials of peace? What put us into uniform, ready to engage the enemy on every continent and every ocean? These two worlds of which Mr. Wallace spoke, free and the slave. Let's take the free world first, our world. How did it become free? Only through a long and unceasing struggle inspired by men of vision. Moses, Muhammad, Confucius, Christ. All believed that in the sight of God, all men were created equal. And from that there developed a spirit among men and nations, which is best expressed in our own Declaration of Freedom. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. It is the cornerstone upon which our nation was built and the ideal of all the great liberators. Washington, Jefferson, Garibaldi, Lafayette, Kosciuszko, Bolivar, Lincoln. Lighthouses, lighting up a dark and foggy world. that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. Fighting, living, dying. For what? For freedom. That for which men have fought since time began. To be free. Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death.